Illinois Facebook Live. I'm Mayor Jim Langfelder. I appreciate you joining us. And it's the fourth session that we've had as a way to engage our public, bring them up to speed with regards to the coronavirus pandemic, and then the challenges we all face and how we can move forward together. That's the most important item. I have the pleasure to join with Misty Buscher, the city treasurer, as well as Director of Office of Budget Management, Bill McCarty. And that's the financial, really the financial oversight chiefs with regards to city operations. So there's a checks and balance of how we operate simultaneously. And it's important that we continue to provide the services each and every day that we have been doing, that everybody expects. Of course, with the pandemic, it's been challenging to all of us. But just like any business, we've had disruptions. How do you continue to operate, keeping your coworkers safe, as well as the public safe, as we move forward and through the stay-at-home order and providing those services? But one thing that is new today is the legislature's back in, being the capital city. Of course, we are targeted for protesters. Many of them are from out of town. You know, and comes with that is the unsightly signs, disfavored, the bad speech, hate speech, that is all deplorable. I think in the home of Abraham Lincoln, I think everybody can agree it's not acceptable. And really, we're in the generation where we should go back to. I grew up in the 60s and 70s, the we generation. How do we work together? And during a pandemic, that's what we should all strive to do. How do we support one another and move in that direction? I think that's keyly important. I think for too long, we've had the me societies in the 80s, and it's continued on. It even continues today. And that's what really saddens me, is because through this pandemic, we should all come together. I don't care what party you are, Democrat, Republican, that should all take a side. But when you look at the federal level all the way down to the state level, even at the local level, sometimes speech divides us, and I'm more of a uniter. I know Treasurer Buscher feels that way. That's why she was elected, you know, because it's all about government of the people, by the people, for the people. So here in Springfield, we don't tolerate hate speech, especially with swastikas. My family came from Vienna, Austria, but I don't care. You know, I said yesterday we had a long, lengthy discussion with regards to how frustrating, how disheartening when people do express hate to one another. It's just not acceptable. I don't care what manner it is, whether it's verbal or physical or any of that. It's not acceptable in Mr. Lincoln's hometown. And but what we need to do is support one another, especially during this pandemic. I think it's keyly important. I think we'll talk about it with regards to businesses. We have individuals on the brink, and that's some of the protesters. They're on the brink of losing everything they had. I received a text yesterday from a dear friend, been in business, I think, 26 years, built up their business, and they're on the brink of losing it all. And so that's the challenge that we all have. And how do we move forward in this difficult challenge to help? As a reminder, it's a health pandemic. And that's what's driving this whole thing, because we do not want a resurgence in the fall and the winter. So we better be getting used to our social distancing. We need to continue our good hygiene. How do we wear face masks when appropriate? And again, the face mask covers your nose and face, but it's to protect others from you in case you're asymptomatic. That's what that's all about. So it's, for individuals that want to express themselves, they may not think it's fair. They want to open up. Best thing to do, if you're going to protest, wear a face mask and keep your social distance so you can show that you will really support other people. You're taking into your mind the consideration for one another. That's what this pandemic should be about. How do we take into consideration each other's health and wellness? We should be practicing that each and every day so we move forward. But overall, for the city of Springfield, I think we're doing a great job. I think the residents has really stepped it up, especially those in these challenging times that might be down both paychecks or one paycheck. And so I think the city as a whole is doing a fantastic job. Actually, the governor has said that when he had talked to me several weeks back. And so we will continue to support the governor's orders. We do actually provide information as we receive it with regards to businesses that are looking to expand their services or reopen. They send how they would do that, and we forward that on to the state of Illinois and the governor's office, and they are taking all that in consideration. But again, the driver, the number one driver for elected official is to make sure our public's safe. And so I'm sure that's what the governor's taking into consideration with everything else. And how do we move forward to make sure that we can provide services, daily services that we all want to get to, because it hurts the city of Springfield, especially with the tax base. I'm sure Bill McCarty's chomping at the bit to talk about taxes. But before we do that, I always yield to the elected official and Misty Buscher, Treasurer Buscher. Those of you that may not realize it, we have a automatic form of government, but they have their each ward that they represent. But the mayor represents the entire city, as does the city clerk, as well as the city treasurer. So she represents each and every one of you. And as we move along, and she'll give an overview here shortly of her office and anything she'd like to do, explain with regards to the challenges that she's faced with the office and outside the office. But if you want to send in your questions, please feel free to do so on the Facebook live feed, and we'll answer as many of those as we can as we move along. So with that, Misty Buscher, I believe she is a native of Springfield, but she can give her background if she'd like, and then talk about the office, and that's essentially the city's banker, being the city treasurer. But we appreciate all the good work she's done, you know, raising the level of awareness and making sure it's a good check and balance with regards to the Office of Budget Management. So Treasurer Buscher, I'll turn it over to you if you'd like to give some oversight, as well as some of the challenges you and your office have faced, and anything else you'd like to share as we've going day to day through this coronavirus pandemic.
Sure. Thank you, Mayor. I really appreciate it. Hello, all. Good afternoon, since it's after 12 noon. I actually was born in Carrollton, Illinois, which is about an hour, a little over an hour from here south. And my parents moved up here when I was in the seventh grade. My father was in the military. He was drafted for Vietnam and never got out, and took a full-time job at Camp Lincoln. So they moved up here, and that's when I became a citizen of this great city of Springfield. I've been here ever since. And my background, as the mayor said, I am the city's banker. My background was, I was a banker at a local bank. I probably shouldn't do advertising, so I won't say their name, but I'd been in banking for 25 years and was ready for a new challenge. And that's when I decided to run for office to be the city's banker. It was a job I felt I was qualified for, and I really enjoy the job. It's a fantastic job. What our office does, to give you an oversight of what happens in the office, is the city treasurer is responsible for all of the money that goes into the city, whether it's city water, light, and power money or city money. We all share the same federal tax ID, and we receive all money coming into the city. We also are responsible for investing that money. We pay all of the bills for either the utility or the city. We pay the payroll, whether it be through ACH or checks. And then we balance every fund. We have different funds that we keep our money aside in. So to speak, Director McCarty, his office, and I work very closely together with these funds. So for instance, the motor vehicle parking fund, that fund pays for what goes into motor vehicle parking downtown. The motor fuel tax fund pays for road improvements. That's what motor fuel tax monies are for, or for infrastructure improvements. So we keep these funds separated, the money separated, so the taxpayers' money is safe, and then we balance that. So that is sort of what our accounting and investing side does. And then our office also has the side of our office that is the fines side, which is the side that I have a lot of respect for, because they get a lot of heat sometimes from constituents. They collect money on fines. They collect money for parking fines, tall grass, garbage violations, Springfield Police Department ordinance violations. Hopefully they're not writing OVNs today. Hopefully the protesters are minding themselves and we don't have any OVNs today. But this fine staff collects and deals with the public with all of that. So they have a pretty stressful job most days. The impact of COVID-19 for the office, we'll talk about that fines division first, is there was the city council passed that we will no longer collect on debt right now to the city. So people are still paying on their own. And if they want to pay a bill to us, a debt, willingly, we take the money, but we're not collecting. We're not sending people to collections. We're not sending people to the state for recovery. We're halting that right now due to COVID. but we do still have money coming in. People are still paying. Hearings are on hold. I'm the hearing officer. The treasurer is the hearing officer for parking hearings. And then we also do hearings with any violation for tall grass or garbage with Public Works. Those have all been on hold, and the mayor oversees Corporation Council, which handles the other parts of the hearings for city violations, and those have been hold on both departments on hold because of COVID-19. We also don't have our inspectors, our Public Works inspectors, leaving their vehicles when they go to check for violations. They're still doing their jobs, they're still checking violations, but because of COVID and the 6-foot rule, they're not leaving their vehicles. So there are a lot less of those going on because they're not entering homes and seeing what's going on at this time. We have, as far as the financial side, those are the changes on the fine side. As far as the financial side, we have successfully, there's one holdout that's gonna get an email from me soon, but we have put every city employee that was not on direct deposit on direct deposit. We just have one left. So because we don't want people handling checks and handling check stubs because of the paper and the COVID, it's too many hands handling it. So we, COVID-19 allowed us to get all that centralized, which was fantastic part of taking less work from different departments and centralizing it into an ACH process. We also are monitoring very closely due to COVID-19, and I'm not gonna steal Director McCarty's thunder, tax revenue money, because the corporate fund today, at the start of the day this morning, before money in and money out, we started today with $15,765,028.08. That's how much money the corporate fund had at the beginning of the day today. Well, Director McCarty will touch on tax revenues in a little bit, but that fund is still looking good because we only have March revenues and we don't have April or May. So the fund, I know I listened to Council Roundup this morning and they were intrigued at how much money we still had, and we do have that kind of money because we have not seen that decrease in taxes yet. Our office is functioning at 100% capacity. We're still doing everything, just things are scaled back a little bit in the fines division. What changes have I noticed for the treasurer's office with COVID-19? The first would be the investment income. In February, the city and utility on all of their money had investment income of $216,088. Last month in April, it was $70,818. That's 33% of what we had gotten before, because of course rates have dropped due to COVID-19, the market has crashed. So already in 1 month, we've lost quite a bit of money just in investment interest. So that is something that we are watching very closely in the treasurer's office. As far as fines, money coming in, right now the traffic division has seen an increase in money from last year. This time last year in 2019, we'd collected $108,000 in the traffic fines. So far in 2020, we're at $111,000. And the reason that is up is a handful of reasons, but the state of Illinois' local debt recovery program pays us well through that. Our collection agency has done very well this year. And then per ordinance, we have a 120-day waiting period from when a violation is written that we actually try to collect on it. So if you think about it, we haven't even gone into the COVID-19 part of that because these collections are 120 days old when they start. So this is debt from last January at the earliest. So we still are doing well on the traffic side with money coming in. On the fine side, their fines are down. We're down about 13,000 so far this year from last year on the fine side as far as ordinance violations and things like that. And that makes sense because COVID-19 people are sheltering in place, so they're getting in less trouble, which is maybe good for the police department. so they're having a lot less stress there maybe. And then as far as other changes that I've noticed, it would be physical changes internally. We have shorter cubicles in here, so we put plexiglass in between the cubicles to keep the staff safe so that there is distancing between them. The staff wipes down surfaces several times a day, almost every hour and a half or so. And we have a cleaning solution they're using to keep everything sanitary. We do have masks. The city has supplied masks for the employees to wear to be safe. We have gloves, so when they handle money, they can wear the gloves. And then we are requesting if someone needs to have us meet them for money, they make an appointment, we meet them out front, outside, we have a guard. So there is a lot of changes there as far as how we're functioning. Moving forward, the mayor asked, what do I see maybe moving forward? is if we get to phase three in June, which is, I think, a minimum goal of all of us, if not more, we will need appointments to meet with people so that we can safely separate our appointments and meet with people in a safe place and make sure they have a mask, provide them with a mask or things like that. We are going to work on assisting other departments because we don't want a lot of people traffic going through City Hall. So we're helping OBM with use tax. We're going to help Public Works with permitting. So we're going to work since we're on the main level and we have a full staff of helping assist other departments with that. And then we're working on online permitting with Public Works, which will be a great, great service to offer. So we do have some things changing, more technology. And I know the mayor is very passionate about more technology-based functions and within the city so that we are more acceptable or our public can get more access to us much faster since we're more online versus in person. So we're going to work on helping all city departments with that as well. But that's kind of our changes thus far, Mayor.
That's a great overview. We appreciate it. One of the things you touched on was the parking, and that's interesting that the numbers had gone up and with the regards to the program. But right now, I believe, isn't it free parking downtown, especially if people want to come down and support their brick and mortar with the grab and go retailers, which in phase three, I think they're going to be opened up where you can actually walk in and do some shopping. Right now, you can do it online. Or even the restaurants downtown. I think the meters are bagged, aren't they, with regards to if someone wants to order something from a restaurant or from a retailer, they can just pull up and get their order right at the curb.
Yes.
Is that correct?
Bagged meters, you want to make sure if it has a blue bag on it in front of a restaurant that you're not a downtown worker parking there because you will get a ticket because the bagged meter is for the restaurant for the curbside pickup. So you need to not use that as your daily parking spot. That's for curbside pickup only if it's got a bag. But parking is free otherwise downtown right now for everyone else. Just leave the bags alone. And then please follow the handicap parking rules because you will get a ticket if you're in a handicap spot and do not belong. Don't block a fire hydrant. Just the normal places you shouldn't park. It's just the normal metered spots you can park at for free. But the mayor's correct. That is all free. But they are still watching. We've had some people get tickets in handicap spots and they're upset. Because they thought it was free. Well, you still can't violate that. You need to follow the state law and not park in a handicap spot if you don't have a handicap placard. So,
yeah, and as businesses begin to open up, or particularly the state of Illinois or the city of Springfield, when we're open up in the municipal center, we will go back to the way it was with regards to plugging the meters, because meters are in place just to move traffic along, especially for our retailers. So that's something we're assessing, but right now you can park, as the treasurer said, downtown free, and just be cautious of not at handicap location, and then at the grab and go areas, we're trying to free up those spots for the retailers and the restaurants so people can just pull up and get their merchandise or their food order. So thank you for that oversight. We'll rejoin because we do have a few questions to go over, but Director McCarty has been a director, actually, he was the OBM director when I was elected mayor, and he did a great job of turning things around during challenging times with the economy. And here, lo and behold, he went 2 years without a state budget. We went through that. We thought, oh, we're doing pretty good. We had like a $20 million fund balance. And lo and behold, the coronavirus hits us, and it hasn't really hit us to the potential it could. But it will eventually, because of the sales tax, flows down to our bottom line, just like any other. But he's been great through these ups and downs of the economy, and has been great to serve the citizens of Springfield. So, Bill, if you'd like to give us an overview and of your office and that, how it coincides with the treasurer's office, and then anything you'd like to share with regards to challenges facing the adversity of the coronavirus and
sure.
Providing service to people. Go ahead.
Sure. Thanks, Mayor. I appreciate it. And hello, everyone out there. Appreciate your time today. Certainly, you're right, Mayor. There have been a lot of ups and downs. Unfortunately, a few more downs than ups here in the last 4 or 5 years. Seems like there's always something, whether it's the state budget or there's coronavirus or, pensions or whatever, the things we've talked about. But, we'll get through it. And one of the reasons that we're on our way, or at least we're ahead of the game when it comes to this coronavirus, is because of the steps that we've been taking with the mayor's leadership and with the work of all the other directors and the staffs. we've been able to really streamline things at the city and to try and save up. One thing the city learned back at the Great Recession was that we need to save for a rainy day. We need to be prepared for the next downturn, because it's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when. And ever since that time, the city has really worked hard to try and build up its reserves. And in fact, I'll get to this a little bit later, at least I intended to, but our reserves ending last year were higher than they've ever been in the corporate or general fund. And that's really helping us out at this point in time. I'll get into more detail, but first I want to give an overview of just what my department does, because my department doesn't have a direct impact. We're not out there filling potholes. We're not out there protecting the citizens of this community. But when I try to describe our importance or what we do, I try to keep it simple. And I just say, we provide the services to the departments that are out there providing services to the citizens. And it's really critical what we do behind the scenes, providing those services, because if you look at it, one of the things, the way I look at it is, if there wasn't a police department or there wasn't a fire department or even a public works department, we could still do what we do. But if there wasn't an office of budget and management, if there wasn't a treasurer's office, the public works departments, the fire departments, the police departments, they couldn't do what they do. And that's a critical distinction that I think that, you know, we hope that people understand. Because we, in my department, we have payroll that we're in charge of, we take care of. Obviously, you got to pay all of our employees. You got to pay those police officers, those firefighters that are out there. We do procurement. So we're the ones who are procuring the goods that they need in order to provide those services, whether it's a fire truck, whether it's asphalt, whatever it might be, that runs through this office. We handle the procurement for that. We handle the budgets for all the departments except for the utility. And we handle the accounting and accounts payable. So we're paying the vendors. If we weren't out there paying the vendors, then those departments wouldn't be able to get the things they need to do what they do for the citizens of Springfield. So, you know, every department here is important, whether they're providing direct services to citizens or not, because we all work together to get it done, to provide those services and provide the protections for the people of this community. So it's kind of what we do here. And then the COVID impact is interesting. For us, it certainly had an impact. One of the things that we do is we do have public that come in here, much like the treasurer's office. We're in Municipal Center West. We do have public that comes in here to either pay use taxes, if they buy a vehicle outside of the city of Springfield. We have vendors who like to come in and drop off their bids or their proposals for RFPs. We also have individuals who come in to pay hotel motel taxes, which obviously is critical revenue for the city. One of the things that we've been able to do or have had to do with the stay-at-home order and the closure of City Hall is we've had to get out communications to all those individuals who might be doing those things to let them know that they can't come here, because we don't want anybody wasting a trip coming downtown to do that and only to get here and not be able to get in the door. So all the communications that we've sent out, whether it's use tax notices, whether it's our bids, all of that had information added to it, stating that we could still collect that stuff, they could still send it, but it would have to be done remotely, it would have to be done through the mail. And one of the things that we're working on getting to is electronic bidding, which I think is the future for our procurement process. But in terms of the workload that we've had here, yeah, we've had folks with the stay-at-home order, we've gone like a lot of other departments here, and we've tried to implement that social distancing. We've tried to continue to operate in an environment of the unknown. And that's really, especially in the month of April, it was what I call the environment of the unknown, when we just didn't know how contagious it was. We didn't know how close people could get. And so the decision was made to try and keep people away from one another as much as possible. So we implemented reduced hours. We implemented flexible hours here. We did the things we need to do, we felt, to keep people safe. And at the same time, keep the trains moving. As somebody I know used to say. So we've been able to do that, and we've been able to do it very well, to the point where we really haven't gotten behind on anything. And in the instances where we did, particularly with accounts payable, we were able to bring in staff a little bit more than they were coming in before, and we were able to catch up. And one of the reasons we could do that, of course, is the other departments are operating in a diminished capacity. And because of that, the amount of workload coming from those departments has been a bit less during the outbreak, during the stay-at-home order. So it's allowed us to pretty much keep up with everything that we're doing and not have any diminishment of services from our department to the other departments. So that's really good. We've just internally, besides the fact that the public couldn't come here, we had to work with other departments. We have a lot of folks coming in, dropping off things from other departments. We had to curtail that as well and insist on getting things done electronically or via interoffice mail. But there just hasn't been anything that's been a huge hindrance to us to getting things done. And so that's certainly been a blessing for us to be able to figure that out and keep things going here in the department. So moving forward, what are we looking at? Well, I think Madam Treasurer was very short and to the point in what she said about how we're going to implement reopening of City Hall and how that's going to work. And she's been very gracious to work with us because her office is on the first floor, we're on the second floor, to help people, prevent people from moving throughout the building as we continue to learn more about the coronavirus and how it spreads and that type of thing. Obviously, try and keep up the physical distancing. So we're going to work with the others. There's a great team of facility folks that are going around trying to implement things. Even here, we're going to put up barriers and do some things that we need to keep both the public and the employees safe. So we're not concerned with having folks back in the building. We just need to make sure it's done in a safe manner for everybody. And I think that we're well on our way to getting those things implemented that we need to do to welcome the public back in so that they can do the business that they need to do with the city of Springfield. We're also looking at more electronics, and I alluded to this earlier. Electronic bidding is quite frankly, electronic bidding is something that has been a pet project of mine for probably 6 or 7 years now. It's been very difficult to implement for a variety of reasons, but we're now at the cusp of being able to get it done. And the coronavirus, if anything, has helped move that along. There were a few things that were dragging that we had to get done, and we've been able to do that. So we're very, very close. It's under the mayor's review now, and hopefully very soon we'll be able to take our bidding out of the Stone Age and into the 21st century. So that will be something that will be more convenient and less costly for not just us internally, but for the public at large, for those vendors who want to respond so that they can respond from anywhere and they can send those things in, those documents in electronically and save themselves a lot of time and effort from having to go to the post office or wherever to get that stuff in and get the notarization done and everything that goes along with it. So we're very excited about that process. We're also looking at internally making sure that we do more things electronically. There's a lot of paper that gets pushed around City Hall, and we've been working on it for years. When I say we, I mean everybody, from the clerk's office to the treasurer's office to the mayor's office to us. We've been working on trying to reduce the amount of paper that goes around City Hall because it's costly and it's unnecessary in today's technological world. So we've made great strides. We're hoping to make even more strides as we go forward and reduce that going along. That'll save money, it'll save time, so certainly make things more efficient, and that's one of the things we're looking at doing. One of the other things, I think the other big thing that we have had success with, and this, and Mayor Langfelder has actually been a big champion of this, is shared services. We started looking at it under the previous administration while I was here under Mayor Houston. One of the things that has been a pretty significant success for the city of Springfield is the fleet consolidation that we did. And that was something that we started back in 2012, and Mayor Houston asked me to spearhead that. And we did, and with the help of a lot of good and smart people, we were able to get it done. It wasn't easy, but we were able to get it done. And we went, for instance, and having 50 people in fleet maintenance around the city, now we have 25. We have a 50% reduction. Multiple buildings down to one, et cetera. And we're saving over $2 million a year. And I think that sort of laid the groundwork for moving forward with more shared services initiatives. And that's something Mayor Langfelder has been championing. And under his leadership and his direction, we've actually been able to put some more of that into place. For instance, we are reducing the number of fiscal officers. Instead of having fiscal officers in every single department or almost every department, we're now looking at some of the smaller ones and we're sharing. So we're looking at two out of seven, you know, roughly, what is that, 30, 40% drop in fiscal officers that we're looking at doing. AP, our accounts payable, we were able to merge. The utility had their own AP department. OBM had its own AP department. We merged that a couple of years ago, and we were able to see a 17% drop in that. And we've also been improving processes because they would do things one way, we would do things one way, and we've been able to look at both sides and take the best of both areas and put them into one AP department. And now we're doing things so much more efficiently and much more quickly that eventually we think that we can probably reduce the size of that department even more. We've seen great success with that. So, you know, fleet and AP and and fiscal officers, all of those things are great examples of how we tried to streamline city government, how to improve our processes and make everything more efficient. We want to, and the point is why do you do that? You do that to be nimble. You do that to be able to respond to situations like the coronavirus, things that you don't see coming, so that you can be reflexive when that time happens and you can get things done and continue to get things done. And you can save money, most importantly, for the citizens of Springfield, yet still getting the work done. So let's talk taxes for a minute.
Bill likes saving money, that's for sure.
I do. I do. Especially now.
The shared services is one of the items that we're looking at. And one question that did come up is with regards to the impact of the coronavirus on the bottom line with regards to revenue sources coming in. So I know usually sales tax come at a two-month lag or anywhere up to a two-month lag. And the months that were critical were March and April. And again, May, until these businesses open up to their full capacity, which is going to be some time. But can you give an idea of what that impact's been with regards to the revenues that typically come in?
Right. Certainly. And that's the thing. Everybody wants to know how bad's it going to be? And the reality is, the answer is, I can't tell you right now. The reason that we can't tell you right now is because sales tax is the single biggest piece of the corporate fund budget. It's almost half. And we don't even have the March numbers yet. I keep looking online every day to the Department of Revenue and it's not posted yet. I looked again this morning. So until we get those March, and really, quite frankly, until I can get the April numbers, and that will be next month, it's really going to be hard for us to determine just the severity of the impact of what we're looking at from a budgetary perspective. Per the mayor's direction, we've run several scenarios, we've made several assumptions, and right now we've run four scenarios, and those four scenarios point to somewhere between, let's say, a $12 and $20 million hit to the corporate fund. Now, we have seen a little bit of positivity with some of the other taxing areas. We do have hotel motel tax numbers for April, and we just got some numbers from May. May would be our April activity collected in May, so I needed to make that distinction. From our SCVB director today, Scott Dahl, gave me some numbers, and they weren't as bad as we had originally projected in some of our scenarios. So we're hoping that we're more in the scenario A and B range, which is in that $12 to $15 million, rather than in the C and D, which is in your $18 to $20 to $21 million range. Now, again, that will be highly dependent upon the sales tax, and we just don't have those numbers yet. But what I have said consistently from the beginning is this impact is going to be dependent upon two things, deft and duration. Deft is how much is the activity dropped off. We don't know the ad for sales tax. We're starting to see it for some of the other areas. And of course, duration. How long is this going to go on? Now we know the physical distancing is going to go on for quite some time, but what degree does that keep people from going into restaurants or going into stores and stimulating that economic activity that we need, quite frankly, to provide services here? Now we know that people are buying things online, for example, but the city of Springfield really doesn't benefit a whole lot from that. That revenue that we would get from buying that item locally at one of our brick and mortar stores would generate sales tax that would come to us. Right now, that's really not in place. There is a sales tax that's collected, but most of that is in the form of a use tax right now, the majority of which goes to the state of Illinois. It really doesn't transition to more of a city sales tax until January of next year. So we're not seeing that. So the impact we're getting from all the online sales, there is economic activity, but unfortunately, our corporate fund, which is, again, about half sales tax, doesn't really see a lot of that activity. And then on top of that, of course, there's the jobs, the employment here in town. The more people are purchasing online and purchasing elsewhere, that's less need for local employees to be able to provide those sales directly to them. So obviously, there's a lot of concerns we had with e-commerce coming into this, and now it's just ratcheted up given the fact that everybody is at home, and the most convenient thing and safe thing, quite frankly, they can do is to order their stuff online, whether it's Walmart, Amazon, or wherever else. And we just don't see a lot of benefit to that right now. Next year, that will change, hopefully, with some of the recent legislation, but it just hasn't changed yet. It's not there. So the fact that people are concerned about going out and how concerned they are and the physical distancing and all that will determine the duration and the depth of what we're looking at. And those are things that none of us have a crystal ball. We just don't know how long that's going to go. I mean, obviously, anecdotally, if you go around town, you can see people out and about more, and certainly a lot of people are champing at the bit to get out and get in restaurants or gyms or whatever the case may be. So, you know, there's some optimism there that if it can be done safely and in the right manner and within, you know, and done lawfully, that we'll see that uptick in economic activity. So I guess I'll just end to get to the mayor's final comments and questions by saying that April is the one I'm really looking for. April is the month that I think will be the low point. And if I can get April, I think that will help a lot in refining our projections for just how deep the impact is going to be on our city budget. But I will say this. I lied. I got one more thing. Sorry. I will say this because I referenced it earlier. We have, the mayor should know better than to have me on here with anybody else because he knows I can do a whole hour by myself. But I will say, and this was alluded to earlier, because of the strides that we have made, the administrations have done, mm-hmm. especially since the Great Recession and then continuing under Mayor Langfelder, FY 2020, the year that just ended, February 28th, our fiscal year, we ended with the highest fund balance that we have ever had in the city of Springfield. And that is going to help us a lot. And I've got the number here somewhere. I don't know where I put it down, but it was about 21%, somewhere around $25, $26 million. We've never been that high before. And because of that, it's going to help us deal with the impact of this coronavirus so that we don't have to do any knee-jerk reactions. We don't have to immediately go out and close down a firehouse or something like that. We can take time to truly understand the depth of the impact and then make reasonable decisions to deal with that. And we're lucky to be in that position because there's a lot of cities around here. If you just read the papers, they're not in the same position and they're panicking and they're doing things now because they're in a position to do that. Luckily, we have put ourselves in a position here in the city to not have to do that. I'm not saying there won't be some kind of repercussions, that we won't have to do something here to balance our budget or rebalance our budget. What I'm saying is we have time to take stock in what's going on and to make reasonable decisions to react accordingly. Thank you, Mayor.
Yeah, and how we'll do, well, thank you for that summation. And as we get the impact of the budget, you know, we're slowing down hiring, we're slowing down our expenditures, cutting those out as much as possible and moving in that direction. We'll continue to be more efficient looking at shared services when that makes sense. We'll do that because the bottom line is we're all here to serve you, the public, and how do we do that through technology or what have you. So we'll continue to do that. If it gets to the point, which more than likely may happen, it's happened in other cities, is gets to the point where you can't spend down fund balance, you'd have to go to furloughs or cuts of or layoffs. But those are almost like last resort for us. But, you know, we're tightening our belt as much as possible, becoming more efficient. One thing that you did point out was interesting was with regards to becoming paperless, because if you talk about the coronavirus, a lot of it is through transmission of paper, you're touching an object, and how individuals are getting it, you know, like 80 to 90% of the time, it's when you touch your face. And so you can, we can pass the paper. I may be asymptomatic, pass it to Director McCarty. He picks it up and he might get the virus that way by just touching his face and unbeknownst. So it's important that we move forward in the technology phase. And Treasurer Buscher had mentioned this, and with regards to the importance of moving that direction. And two things. One is the online permitting, if you'd like to make any comments on that, but also the ARIA system. That's one that we have, speaking of dinosaurs, you have departments that collect funds for different avenues, but we're trying to integrate all those systems into one. So if you'd want to talk about the technology of the process of, you know, the cash flow, that'd probably be helpful. And then I have a couple other questions we can run through real quick.
Sure. Yeah, the ARIA system, the mayor had actually started when he was the treasurer. And when he was here, they had the ARIA system to put fines into that were from like Public Works or the police department. But then the traffic ticket system, it was called TTS, took care of all traffic tickets. And then the accounting side had a system called TCA, Treasurer's Cash Accounting System. So when I came in, I built upon the mayor's original ARIA, and we have ARIA version 2 now. And all those are all in the one system now, ARIA 2. So every violation is in the same system, which the mayor is talking about putting all the department's debt in that one system. And then our accounting division uses that system. And the nice part about our accounting division using that system now is all of our reports we would put out on a daily basis even, we used to have to send physical reports to Bill's office in OBM. We no longer do that. His office has access to the ARIA system and they just log in and get it. So not only are we paperless, we're technology miles ahead because we don't have OBM saving the same documents in their computer as my office was. It's all saved in the one software that everyone has access to. The financial division of the utility also has access to that area so that they can pull those reports and see them themselves. So if we as a city can move forward in multiple departments doing this, it will only, A, as the mayor is saying, help with less paper, but then B, communication would be so much faster amongst departments as well.
Yeah, and that's, it touches various departments in the ARIA system. City Works is one that we've talked about previously with any type of work being done by Public Works or CWLP, but how do we integrate all those together, as well as the online bids that we're moving towards, as Director McCarty had stated. But the that's one of the things the pandemic has taught us is everybody, businesses, government as well, we need to change the way we do business and move forward towards the future. And how do we provide those services and as least disruptive as possible when we have these emergency declarations? The one aspect is the Treasurer Bush has helped out with, they're over in Municipal Center West, is with regards to opening up the Municipal Center. And you know, first you have to go and take a look at your workspace. As you bring people back in with the social distancing, how do you make that safer with plexiglass was mentioned, and reconfigure, you know, kind of making the spaces more usable so we can keep our social distance, but also in the common areas with regards to Municipal Hall. So we're, you know, trying to target June 1st as the opening up date. That first week or so, I would imagine it's going to be, as was mentioned, appointment only, but we'll know more next week. But if you'd like to share some of the challenges or some of the assessments we've done, what that you would like, Treasurer Buscher, and that whole dynamic.
Absolutely. So the mayor has a team, and I'm on his team to help open the Municipal Center West to the public so that it's safe not only for the public, but for our employees as well. And what we have done is removed a lot of the barriers on the hallways. There used to be chairs for waiting. We've removed all that so we can keep a 6 feet distance in the hallways. And then we're going to put places where people can stand 6 feet apart so that they will know where they will stand to wait in line, for instance, at the commercial office to pay their utility bill, or at my office or the clerk's office. We're also looking at the council chambers. That was a big one because we have seating in there, but to be 6 feet apart, you need to have 3 seats in between each person. So we've looked at that so we know how to seat people in the council chambers when we can get to the point of 50 or less, how we can put people in there and still keep them safe. We have hand sanitizing stations on every level and in the elevators. We're Director Bottom, his entire department in Public Works, he has a whole department there that's in charge of keeping our buildings clean and safe. And so they are wiping down door handles every hour on the hour, wiping down the elevator buttons. So Director Bottom has taken that on. And then one of the things that multiple businesses, my husband's self-employed, one of the things multiple businesses are working on is, do you take temperatures of people when they come in or not? Is that a liability, or is it a thing you should or shouldn't do? So that's something our group has talked about and shared some information with the mayor on, because you have to think about not only your employees, but the public. So those are some of the things we're still working through, whether that's a good thing or a bad thing to do to take people's temperatures as they come in the building. But we are going to make sure all citizens are safe, that there's social distance. The guard will make sure that there is a face mask in use or a face covering of some sort when they come in. And we're just working very hard to make sure when we open the doors that people will still have their services, but they'll be safe.
Well, thank you for that overview. And if you want to look up any information, you can go to our website, springfield.il.us. And we do have a COVID-19 webpage, and it not only has Springfield information, but also links to the state and federal CDC guidelines, public health. So it's a lot of wealth of information right there and support for businesses as well. One of the things that questions that did come in, and this is typical of any time you run into a financial difficulty, is with regards to hiring and slowing down the hiring and the essential need for hiring freeze. And I don't know, Director McCarty, if you've ever experienced that, but from our standpoint, there's certain positions you will need to fill And so we're taking it as it goes. It's not a across-the-board hiring freeze. We're not filling vacant positions. We're slowing those down, and the ones that don't need filled, they will go unfilled. So I don't know if you have anything you want to share on the consideration about hiring freeze, Director McCarty.
Right. Well, we've been through this, again, as you started this out, there have been ups and downs in the 9 years that I've been here, and we've certainly looked at this a couple of times. And one of the things that we've been doing the last couple of years is we've faced these fiscal challenges is it's not a hiring freeze per se, but more of a hiring or rehiring assessment. And it used to be back when times were better that you could go out, if you lost a person, you would just go out and hire. If you needed a person or felt you needed a person in the department, you would just go out and you would hire. Those days are gone right now because of what we've been facing. And so, yeah, anytime somebody leaves, there's an assessment of whether or not that position needs to be refilled and whether it needs to be refilled right away. Is it a position that could perhaps be combined? Could a couple of other people take on those duties? Can you split them off? And that goes back to our shared services and trying to be more nimble, more efficient. And if you go back and you look at city headcount a decade or so ago, maybe a little bit more than a decade, I guess now, gosh, I forget how long I've been here. Probably 12 or 13 years was around 1,800 people, and we're down to under 1,400 right now. I think we're budgeted somewhere around 1,400, and that just goes to show that there's been a real honest assessment of city employment, whether or not we can afford to keep doing the things we've always, the way we've always done them, and quite frankly, we can't. Not if we want to continue to provide the service levels that we're providing. So it's important to look at each and every position when it leaves and whether or not it needs to be filled. And right now, one of the first things the mayor had us do when this COVID thing hit is he sent out a memo. He and I sent out a memo that said all non-essential spending needs to stop. It needs to cease. If you need to spend it to provide services and keep the lights on, sure. But if you've got something that can wait, it needs to wait. And then also implementing a reserve on budget. One of the ways that a lot of departments are trying to reach those budget reserve requirements is by slowing down their hiring, by holding off, whether it's 3, 4, 6 months, whatever the case is. And I'm a prime example of that. I've got 3 open fiscal officer positions right now that need to be filled. We had done first interviews right before the stay-at-home order hit. We haven't done the second interview since because we're trying to hold off as long as possible on that, knowing that we need to save money in our department, and a lot of other departments are doing the same thing. But that isn't stopping people from hiring if it absolutely is a necessary position. It's just making sure that people take a real, true, honest assessment and they just don't go say, yeah, just backfill it without thinking mm-hmm. about it.
So thank you. One of the questions that came in, and Treasurer Buscher touched on it with regards to number of individuals allowed. Right now, I think when phase 3 kicks in, which is essentially beginning of June, that will allow 10 or less individuals to gather. And so city council, you know, we have 10 aldermen and alderwomen. So with that, the question is, when do we increase to over 10? And that would be phase 4, and that would be July 1st, according to the parameters originally set out by the governor. And what the metrics are how much occupied bed space and ventilator space is being taken up at the hospitals, and then also on the testing, the percentage of the testing with regards to the positives to the negatives that's happening. So the more you test, of course, you're going to have more positives. The good news is that in our region, which is Region 3, and especially in Sangamon County and Springfield, we're below that threshold, well below it. I think it's like 6 or 8% right now. I think it's 8%. So with the testing, so we continue to do that. And that's a lot of thanks to you, because everybody's being cognizant of keeping our social distancing, now wearing the mask as much as possible. No handshakes. That's kind of gone out the window forever, I think, as we move forward. But with the gatherings of 50 or more, that won't be until July, more than likely. But the governor, again, is assessing, this is a fluid plan. When they introduced it, there has been some flexibility. They did create regions where previously they didn't think they would. And so they'll continue to look at it. In phase 3, what would open up are the barber shops, you know, if you need your haircut, or retail spaces, especially the other stores that hadn't been open, can reopen, moving in that direction, manufacturing and some offices. And we're also trying to get restaurants open to a lower capacity instead of waiting till July where they open up at 50%. Maybe they can consider opening up at a lesser capacity. So I know the push from a lot of different entities and individuals like ourselves has been trying to get them open, because I think that will help in the long run with their viability as we move forward. So the other thing real quick on a couple other items, one is with the municipal band, that's something that's a summer event that's enjoyed by many at Lincoln or Douglas Park rather, and some other venues. But with the crowd size, it's not, it limits their ability to do anything. We're hoping that they would be able to perform a concert or two before fall comes, but really, again, it depends on the coronavirus spread, how we move along the parameters of the phase in, the Restore Illinois approach that the governor's laid out. So time will tell with that. We haven't canceled the season in its entirety, but of course, for May and June, it's limited. Hopefully, 4th of July, we'd be able to hear them play some of the patriotic tunes in some type of venue, but time will tell on that, and we'll keep you posted as we move along. The other thing is with sporting events, and I think it's the same thing, it's with the number of people that you can have access to. I think if you have a sports team or something of that nature, you don't increase to 10 until June 1st. So that's gonna hamper what your ability is with regards to that. So I know you can do pickleball, I believe, one-on-one, that's similar to tennis, but there's some activities you can partake in right now just with two individuals, but that should open up June 1st. And I don't know, Treasurer Director McCarty, if you want to weigh in on any of that, but from my knowledge, that's where that's at. It's gonna be mainly driven as we move along the different phases of the Restore Illinois and reopening.
Yeah, that what you've just said is everything that I've heard as well, and what we talk about in the incident management team. So it's all based on phases. It's, and each phase has certain characteristics that are associated with the crowd size and that type of thing. So it's just a matter of moving through the phases. And the best way we can do that is to make sure that we continue to follow the CDC guidelines and everything else for physical distancing and being careful and washing hands, that type of thing. The more we can do that and stop the spread and reduce the numbers that are coming out Sangamon County and the other central Illinois counties that we're associated with in terms of phases, yeah, that's how we get there.
Mm-hmm. I don't know, Treasurer Buscher, if you have any closing comments or any other comments you'd like to make on that. I know you'd mentioned businesses that your husband's involved with or other individuals that you know, and anything you'd like to share from that capacity?
Anything else? Say that if anyone can support local restaurants and try to eat out, curbside pickup two or three times a week, that would be fantastic. Not only the restaurant owners, but the staff that works there, that is their income, and they need that money. So I know I've tried very hard to do that, and also tried to tip extra this time, because then you would, if you were sitting inside the restaurant, because their income really has been cut. I would like to thank our citizens for being so terrific, and I know last night during our council meeting, there were some aldermen upset about some of the protesters and the things they were displaying. But in my heart, I don't think those people were probably Springfield citizens. We have a lot of people coming in from out of town for these protests. So I'm very proud of our citizens, and I think they've handled things well. So I just want to thank them for working with all of us during this time as well. And I support small business owners. I know it's tough, and I feel bad for them.
Those are all good points. I appreciate you mentioning that. And with regards to that, our police department, fire department, all the first responders, healthcare, they've all done a fantastic job, as well as, janitorial staff, as well as retail workers. And it's important that we really support one another. That's what it's all about, is how do we rise above all the, chatter, if you will, because you're hearing it on the federal level. Because these are challenging times, and we really need to embrace supporting one another. That's what it's all about, being cognizant of paying respect to one another. How do we maintain our, positive attitude and making sure that we keep each and everyone healthy and moving forward in that direction? Well, one of the things the city of Springfield's done, again, as you pointed out, the residents done a fantastic job, but city services, we kept the lights on, water running. We are filling the potholes. It's been a challenge with regards to that. But the other thing is the rail improvements, that continues on. Someone asked a question with regards to buying up the property, moving the rail project forward. That continues on. and it has a missed beat. And I know right now they're doing the 5th and 6th Street underpasses, and it's important that we continue those construction work so we don't fall too far behind. And I think someone mentioned how long last night's city council meeting was. It's a lot due to the zoning. We kept it going thanks to Tom Chi, who helps with this process with Facebook Live, Julia Prevert, and making sure that we can zoom in, and actually we were able to move forward in that direction, as well as Matt McLaughlin. He's our zoning administrator, where other cities weren't able to do so. So it's important that we continue to move on, support one another, especially the local businesses, as Treasurer Buscher's mentioned, because the bottom line is it helps all of us. That's our neighbors. It does flow through to our tax dollars. That does provide the services. So we're able to, thanks to you, we're able to provide those services each and every day. And so I continue to be supportive. If you have suggestions, go to feedback, or you can send an email to feedback@springfield.il.us. Send in your comments. We like constructive criticism. That's always welcome. You know, we do take critiques, but it's also nice to get those suggestions so we can move forward, because when it's all said and done, what we're trying to do is make today better than yesterday and tomorrow better than today. And we all can do it by doing it together. So let's support one another as we move forward in this challenging time, and we will make our future a lot better than it looks like today, and by supporting one another and moving forward in a positive direction. So thank you for tuning in. And again, share your comments if you like, and visit our website with additional information at springfield.il.us. So next Wednesday, Facebook Live is with, actually we're spinning it a little bit different, with Alderman Donlin of Ward 9 and Alderman Hanauer of Ward 10. And we're asking them to get a business person from each of their wards to give that perspective, because that will be right before phase 3 enters in. So it gives us a unique perspective. So hopefully you can join us at that point in time. And until then, stay healthy and well. Take care.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.